So I will speak about two examples. In almost complex hyperbolicity. So this is the right title, not the one which was on the board, which was, I think, the title of Jean-Pierre de Mailly last week. Why almost like that? Because I'm not a specialist in almost complex geometry and more in complex geometry. And you are now very, very good specialists in almost complex curves. And what I want to do is to explain two results in complex hyperbolicity, which translate without any effort to the almost complex world. Okay, and maybe for my comfort, I will present them in the complex setting and tell you what has to be done in order to convert them to the almost complex setting. So what are these examples? So I'm speaking about global results. The first one is very... Yes, the first one is a basic one, which is valid for any complex hyperbolic compact manifold. And this is a linear isoperimetric inequality. For holomorphic disks inside the manifold. So I will explain more later on. And this will be the topic of the lecture today. And the second result, which I will talk about tomorrow, it's a classical example of a hyperbolic manifold, which is a complement. So this is a Green theorem. Namely, if you start with P2, and you remove in it five lines in general position, then you get a manifold which is a hyperbolic. And this is the right generalization in dimension 2 of the classical result of Picard. P1 of C minus 3 points in general position, that means 3 distinct points, is hyperbolic. And as you know, there is no difference in one dimension between the complex and almost complex worlds. But in dimension 2, there are differences. And so in order to be able to state a similar theorem in the almost complex case, you have to change the method of proving this theorem in the complex case. So what I will do tomorrow is to prove in a very, in my sense, geometrical way this theorem in order to be able to pass to the almost complex case. So I will start today with this. I will recall you things, basic things about complex hyperbolicity which I think Jean-Pierre de Mailly has told about last week. So I start with a manifold, a complex manifold. I define the Kobayashi pseudometric by this, taking a point P in the manifold X and V, a tangent vector to X at P. Then you define this like the infimum over all the 1 over R strictly positive, such that there exists an holomorphic disk passing through P and with a derivative which is proportional to V with the parameter of proportionality which is R. Okay, so this is the definition that you know, which is Kobayashi pseudometric. And we say that X is hyperbolic if K is non-degenerate. Meaning that if you have a lack of, if you have a point where this pseudometric is degenerated, that means that through this point pass a lot of very large holomorphic disks. So no large holomorphic disk. Okay. This is the definition. In the compact case, you have a characterization by Brody of compact complex hyperbolic manifold. If you start with X being compact complex, then X is hyperbolic if and only if it doesn't contain a non-constant entire curve. Non-constant entire curve, meaning some holomorphic image of C which is non-constant. Okay. The way entire curves are related to the degeneracy of the Kobayashi pseudometric is by means of Brody's lemma, this is this lemma which explains this equivalence. I will state it like this. So start with X being compact complex. And given a sequence of disks, holomorphic disks, in it, in such a way that the derivative at the origin blows up, or even, I will take it like that, the supremum of the derivative blows up. Here, I measure this derivative So measured in the hyperbolic metric on D, and in some given Hermitian metric on X. So given such a sequence of disks, then you are able to reparameterize it in such a way that up to some extraction, you converge toward a non-constant entire curve. So there exists some sequence of reparametrization of C in such a way that when you composed Fn with phi n, you go on a compact set of C toward some holomorphic map from C to X, which is non-constant. And the blowing up of this derivative is clearly related to the degeneracy of the Kobayashi pseudometric. So when this degenerates, you make appear like that some entire curve. So this is the first characterization, which is very classical, of hyperbolicity for compact complex manifold. Now what I want to do is something similar, but in involving not the presence of some entire curve like that, or the absence, but some isoperimetric inequality. At this level, like that, everything can be done right like this in the almost complex setting. You have a lot of J holomorphic disks. You can build out of them some Kobayashi pseudometric. The Brody's lemma holds true in the almost complex setting. And so you get this characterization. X is hyperbolic if and only if it does not contain any non-constant entire J curve, J holomorphic curve. Okay? So my the theorem I want to speak about is some characterization like that. When you start with some compact complex manifold, then X is hyperbolic if and only if any holomorphic disk in it satisfies some linear isoperimetric inequality. So given J, G, Hermitian metric, there exists some constant C such that for any holomorphic disk delta in X, then you have the area of delta computed with this G less than some constant, this constant, the length of the boundary of delta computed with this G. this is a linear isoperimetric inequality. And if it holds true for any disk, then the manifold is hyperbolic and vice versa. Okay? This choice of some given Hermitian metric does not matter. It will, if you change the Hermitian metric, you will change the constant, but not the fact that you have a linear isoperimetric inequality. So change of G changes C, but not the fact that you get a linear isoperimetric inequality. Yes?
It's a holomorphic disk.
Sorry?
Holomorphic disk.
What is a holomorphic disk? It's a holomorphic image of the unit disk in X. So here I have parameterized it. Here, for just a small moment, I have not parameterized it. But I will again do it. Okay? Any other questions? It's clear? So, some comment about this statement, and after that, I will prove it in the remaining time. The proof goes. Involves only classical and elementary differential geometry of surfaces. It's not hard. We'll see. A comment. A linear isoperimetric inequality is very related to the negative curvature. So in some sense, this tells you that the Kobayashi metric has a negative curvature, but I cannot define what is the negative curvature or the curvature of some Finsler metric like that. So, but in some sense, tells that this Kobayashi metric has negative curvature. If you want to look at the basic models, let's say in dimension one, so if you want to look to the disk, or to C, or to P1, here you have a geometry which is hyperbolic, given by this type of length element. Here you have a geometry which is Euclidean. And here, elliptic, if you want. And this is a model of curvature minus one or minus something constant. It depends on the normalization. So this is of curvature zero, and this is of curvature plus one. Here, you do have isoperimetric inequality, linear isoperimetric inequality for any disk in it. And by the way, I will be obliged to show you how to have this linear isoperimetric inequality even in the disk for this metric. Here, it's well known that you have an isoperimetric inequality, but which is not linear, it is quadratic.
And there?
You don't have any isoperimetric inequality. No isoperimetric inequality. You might have a large disk with large area with very small boundary. Like this, you remove a small disk, you take the complement, you have a large area which is not controlled in any way by the length. Okay? So it's really a phenomenon linked to the negative curvature. Now I will enter slowly the proof, which is, like I said before, classical differential geometry of surfaces, dimension 2 real surfaces. So first, I will explain the following sense, the easiest sense. So if you do have some inequality like that, then x is hyperbolic. So linear isoperimetric inequality implies hyperbolicity. So if not, I will prove the contraposition of that. So non-hyperbolicity forbids a linear isoperimetric inequality. And for this, I will use Brody's lemma. So if you are not hyperbolic in some compact complex manifold, then you get an entire curve. So you get f from C to x, which is holomorphic and non-constant. And now you have some image of C, and we have seen for the usual metric that you don't have a linear isoperimetric inequality, but just a quadratic isoperimetric inequality. For the pullback of the metric on x, which is not the usual one, but which is conformal to that one, we will see exactly the same. So we don't have no linear isoperimetric inequality. And this is mainly the content of Alfors lemma. Which I will explain now, because it's at the part of the techniques which will come after. So what is this? This lemma, it tells you that if you have some image of C like that, entire curve, then you might find inside it a sequence of disks. No. Say in F of C, you have a sequence of disks of holomorphic disk such that the length
of the boundary of it divided by the area of it goes to zero.
This is the length, and this is the area. So I will keep this notation as which are more quick. And as soon as you have this, you cannot have an isoperimetric inequality. And where does it does this result come from? So proof. This disk, you will see them just as concentric disks inside the entire curve. So you start with d of radius t centered at the origin, and you look at the image of it. And after that, I will extract some subsequence. Okay. Now, what I do is the following: I pull back the metric of x by f. So I write this metric like a conformal factor times the Euclidean metric, like that. And now I compute explicitly the area and the length of those images, those holomorphic disk delta t. So A of t will be the area of that. And if you compute explicitly in polar coordinates, you get the following. Maybe I will put here r. The integral from 0 to r, integral from 0 to 2 pi, this conformal factor times the area element in polar coordinate, which is t dt d. C'est ça. Okay? And in particular, when you differentiate this with respect to r, you get the following. You will get the integral over the circle of phi to the square r d theta. Now, what about the length of the boundary? It is directly, if you take the length element of this metric, so just the square root of this, phi r d theta. Now, what is involved is Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Which tells you that when you square this length and you apply Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to the integral, you will get, if I don't mistake, this. Okay? Now it's we are almost done. So you divide by a square, and you integrate, say, between 1 and infinity. I am really interested in this ratio, L over A. This is bounded from above by the primitive of this, which is 1 over A between 1 and plus infinity with the good sign. So you get this. And this is the main point is that it is bounded. OK? Now look at this integral on the left. You have some integral with the coefficient, which the ratio which we are interested in, against some weight which is divergent. The integral between 1 and plus infinity of this is plus infinity. So the limanth of L over A should be equal to 0. And this is exactly what I wanted. So I can extract a sequence of R over N, which gives you exactly this sequence of disks. OK? This is Alfors lemma, which tells you this sense. Now I will look at the other direction. So the hypothesis is that my manifold is a compact, complex hyperbolic. And I would like to have, for any disk, linear isoperimetric inequality. So for simplicity, so take a disk. That I will suppose that I can enlarge slightly it, so he lives inside a slightly larger disk delta tilde. If it is not the case, in any case, to state some linear isoperimetric inequality, I have to have some regularity of the disk up to the boundary. So I have to be able to compute the length of the boundary. So at the boundary, I have some regularity. Here, I assume that I have a lot of regularity in the way that I can extend it slightly analytically. It's just some technical it simplifies the proof, but it's just technical. Now I parameterize this slightly larger disk, delta tilde, by the unit disk. And I assume, for instance, that the disk I am interested in is the image of a slightly smaller disk, inside the unit disk. It's just a detail, it doesn't matter. So. Okay? And what I want to do is to be able to prove some isoperimetric inequality for this smaller disk. Say, I want to prove linear isoperimetric inequality for the round slightly smaller disk with respect to the pullback of the metric G. With respect to the metric G pullbacked on D by F. Okay? This is what I want to do. And now I have reduced the problem to just a two-dimensional problem with respect to some metric, Riemannian metric on the disk. But I know some things about this metric. I know two things, which makes sure that this metric is not too far from the hyperbolic one in some sense. And this will enable you to prove the isoperimetric inequality. So facts. So I want to compare it to the hyperbolic metric on the disk D. So first, this metric is conformal to the hyperbolic metric on the disk. H is the hyperbolic metric and the factor of conformality phi square is bounded. So the first fact this factor is bounded independently of F. The bound depends only on G. And this is really the content of Brody's lemma. This is the first point. And the second point is that the curvature of this metric, even if it is not negative, is bounded from above, donc from above. And here also the curvature is bounded from above. Independently of F. The second point is, for instance, for those who know a bit of complex geometry, so in Keller geometry, we know some fact. A fact is the following. When you take a Keller manifold and you take a submanifold in it, then its curvature decreases with respect to the ambient curvature. So this in Keller geometry, the curvature of a submanifold is bounded from above by the curvature of the manifold. So in the general case, or even in the almost complex case, you have to do a bit more work. But this general principle holds true still. You get a bound from above for any geomorphic curve, for the curvature on this geohomomorphic curve by some invariant which is only expressed by the manifold itself, which comes from the manifold itself. Okay, so maybe I will come back to this point two later on. You have these two points. The first one is only a consequence of Brody lemma. The second one is a bit more complicated. Now, for simplicity, if you want, you may rescale the metric by rescaling the metric. You might normalize one of these two bounds. The one, if you increase the metric, you decrease the curvature, the ambient curvature. So this second bound, you might be able to push it down to one, let's say, to some constant. So I will assume, by rescaling G, assume that this will change the bound for the first one as well. So assume that the conformal factor is bounded by some explicit constant, B, and the curvature of the pullback of G is bounded by 1. So assume that it is 1 here. OK, so this is what I know about this metric, which is pulled back from the ambient manifold. Now, what to do with this? In order to get isoperimetric inequalities, there is a method to do that on surfaces, a classical method, which is due to Ball and Fiala, which is the method of parallel curves. Okay, so I will explain a little bit what is it. What it is. So inside the disk, you have a metric which is the pullback of the ambient metric by F. Inside the disk, you have a domain which is a disk itself topologically, which is your time zero object. And you want to prove the linear isoperimetric inequality for D0. So you want to prove that with obvious notation, this holds true, where I compute the area of D0 and the length of the boundary with respect to this pullback metric. Okay. To do that, you look at A of T and L of T when you make evolve the domain by shrinking it with parallel curves. So you start to shrink it assuming that the curves at the boundary are parallel, meaning that the distance between the two curves is t. Or if you want more precisely, you start here, you take a geodesic which is orthogonal to the boundary like that, and you follow it for time t. When you parameterize it with a length 1, with a speed 1, okay? Or another way to say that, D of T is exactly the set of points inside the domain D0, such that the distance for this metric to the boundary of D0 is precisely is more than t. Okay. So at the beginning, everything is very nice. So you get still a disk, there's a slightly smaller disk with a nice boundary, etc. But you might have some accidents, which I will quickly ignore. But I tell you about them a bit. So possible accidents. Your domain, which is a disk at the beginning, can split into two parts, which are still two disks. For instance, when you start with a thing like that, this is D0 inside the plane with the Euclidean metric, and you start shrinking. And at some point, you will get a cusp. A double point with two cusps, if you want. And after that, you will get two disks. And you continue the shrinking. Okay? So this is the first type of accident. Another type, without changing the topology, you may have some angular points. If you look at some point with a lot of curvature like that, and after that much less, and you start putting parallel curves, at some point, you will have some angular point. Okay, this can be analyzed precisely, and it's not difficult. This is the first touching point of the caustic of this curve, or of the envelope of the normal. So this is the second type of accident. But I will forget about them. For simplicity. And now, I want to follow the behavior of the area of T and the length of T during this time. This time is finite. There is an extension time. After some time t, you get a point here, and after that, nothing. Okay? So this is a finite process. Now, I will first explain a particular case, so a special case. When you look at the hyperbolic metric itself. So, okay. So, say the curvature is minus one. And the factor is one. Okay, so the very simple case. So, and I want to prove an isoperimetric linear inequality for this particular metric. The first point is to understand how behaves the derivative of these guys. It's not very difficult to see that when you differentiate A. So A is decreasing, huh? So this should be a negative quantity, and this is minus L of t. Mm. minus the length. This is the first case, the first differential equation linking these two quantities. And the second is coming from Gauss-Bonnet. What Gauss-Bonnet theorem tells you is the following. If you compute the full curvature on the disk dt, against the area element, and you add the boundary term, which is the geodesic curvature of the boundary. So this is the geodesic curvature. This is the curvature. This is the area element. This is the length element for the metric I'm talking about here, h. This should be actually a topological quantity, 2 pi times the Euler characteristic of the domain I'm looking at. So 2 pi. It's fixed. Now I am in curvature minus 1, precisely. This is minus 1. So this is minus a of t. And another thing which should come from the fact that it's a computation, but not very difficult, but you have to know about the definition of this geodesic curvature. This is precisely the derivative up to the sign of the length. So what I get is that. Remark, you may have here more than 2 pi if you divide into two disks and so on. But still, what you keep having is some positive quantity. So what I will keep from this equality is some inequality, meaning that so you get that, simply that. Now, how to get, in the end, some isoparametric inequality? It's very easy. I will try. So you just multiply by L you remember that minus L is the derivative of A. And you integrate between time zero and extinction time. So you integrate this. This is okay. At the extinction time, everything vanishes. At the time zero, this is precisely the quantity you wanted to analyze. So what you get is or if you want this isoparametric inequality with a factor one. So this is the case of the hyperbolic metric, the curvature minus one metric. Now, what about the general case? For small disks, it will follow almost the same scheme. But for large disks, I will have to input the information that the conformal factor remains bounded. So what about the general case? I start exactly in the same way. So the first equation holds true still. For the second, Gauss-Bonnet theorem, so I keep writing it like that. This is still true. The derivative of L is minus the geodesic curvature integrated along the boundary, like that. But here you have only a bound which is k minus than 1. We know that k is less than 1. And so you get that plus a of t minus l prime equal to pi, or more generally, is positive. Okay, the second is changed like that. Now we'll use this second inequality in some very basic way. So, so I will integrate between times. So by integrating between time t and time zero, time zero and time t. You will get L less than L0 times the integral of A between 0 and t. But I can also be very rough. A is decreasing. So I can estimate it just by A0. So like that. OK? So I get something like that. And now, if I input this, so I have minus a prime less than that. I integrate again. What I get is a0 less than a plus l0t plus a0t squared over 2. OK? Now I will look to the extinction time, and I will discuss between the case where this extinction time is small or is big. Namely, it means that the disk at the beginning was small somehow, so of some of smaller diameter or big. Okay. So I will look to t, which is not exactly the extension time, but say the half extension time. So t, it's such that a of t is half of the area at the beginning. Okay. Now, if this half extension time is small enough, let's say 1/2, what I get is some linear isoperimetric inequality for A0 and L0 just by computing from this. So I will do that. So this is A of t. So t is less than 1/2. Like that. So I get certainly some isoparametric inequality. Yeah? So we are done. Okay. Now this, if this time is bigger than 1/2, I have to input another ingredient. This is the case where I am very parallel to the hyperbolic metric. So for t bigger than 1/2, I have to input some more inequality, which I will tell you about. We have, actually, the integral from 0 to t of the inverse of the length, which is bounded by, I don't remember what, b over a or something like that. So we have something like that, some inequality like that. I will tell you where it comes from. We have this kind of inequality, so it involves this bound b of the conformal factor. So it's really related to this bound. And now, if you want to use it, you just apply all this. So you can bound this from below by. So I will take the rough bound L0 like that. I will integrate up to the extension time, which means that this is the half of A0. And now I will compute this explicitly. So this is should be something like that. So you are able to simplify by this. And you might, because t is bigger than 1/2, still have a bound from below by that. Okay, donc this is 1 plus 1/2 of A0 over L0. Okay? So you take the exponential and you get exactly what you want, a bound from above of the ratio A0 over L0. By exponential 2b minus 1 times 2, something like that. An explicit bound with respect to this bound b from the beginning. Okay? This comes from that. Now, so this finishes the proof up to this inequality. So I will tell you a little bit about this inequality. If you have still the comparison
of the two metric, remember, you have this and that.
You have this deformation of domain, and you measure the area and the length with respect to the metric which is here. You might also measure the area and the length with respect to the hyperbolic metric.
So this I will call AH LH
and of T.
And we add A of T, L of T.
Okay. And you have some comparison between them, but I want to prove this carefully. So what I have to do is to compute the derivative of AH with respect to the time, T. And exactly in the same way as before, we get this. The conformal factor power minus 2 with respect to the length area, the length element for the first metric. Huh? So I get exactly that. And moreover, this is obvious, the length with respect to h is nothing but that. Okay. Sorry, there is a sign somewhere because still the area decreases like that. Okay. Now, I make still a Cauchy-Schwarz inequality on this length. So LH square, this is that square. And by Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, which is exactly the same argument as I gave for Alfors lemma, I get this times that. Okay? And this is nothing but minus the derivative of AH times the length with respect to the metric F star G, so L. Now I think I'm almost done. So I have the inequality I wanted to. I input now the isoperimetric inequality for the hyperbolic metric, which I proved before. This is more than h squared. This is the isoperimetric, linear isoperimetric inequality for H. And now I am still with differential inequality, which I know very well, which is 1 over L less than minus A prime H over AH square, which I integrate now. So this is less than 1 over AH of T minus something, which I forget. And now I am able to compare with 1 over A if I put up upstairs this bound B just I started with.
So this is B over A.
Okay. And so I finish like that the proof of this inequality. So again, it's nothing but a classical ingredient of differential geometry of surfaces. Nothing but that. This argument was more or less completely done by Bruce Kleiner. So I will give you some reference. Unfortunately, this paper was not published. So references. So this argument, or mainly the second part of this argument, so this one using this inequality is due to Bruce Kleiner, unpublished. Benoît Saleur has written something around the same argument, something more general, and this has been published somewhere. And maybe for background on differential geometry, in this context, I would recommend, but I have not found it in the library, the book by Ondin Lafontaine. Curves in almost complex geometry or in symplectic geometry. And inside it, the chapter 3, which speaks about differential geometry in this context. So it's a chapter by Lafontaine. Called some relevant differential geometry. And in particular, there is at the end of this chapter some appendix by Marie-Paul Muller, where she does precisely isoperimetric inequalities by this Boll-Fiala method, and you have some nice drawings and things like that. So precisely on isoperimetric inequalities. What else? So I have still a bit of time remaining. I won't go, so I have to go up to 5. Yeah. But I won't I won't do that. But still, I had this a point, one of the two facts I spoke about, the fact that the curvature for some submanifold was bounded from above by some constant depending only on the ambient manifold. So just about it was fact point two. It was this bound on the curvature, bound independent of f of the curvature. So I will just say a few words about it. So it's still differential geometry, sorry for that. You have some metric which is ambient, which induces a metric on the holomorphic curve or geohomomorphic curve, if you want. And I want to compare the curvature of them. And for that, there is a tool, which is a Gauss equation, which relates precisely the ambient curvature to the induced curvature. So in our context, so I will take, sorry for the notation, this is not anymore a manifold, it is a tangent vector field. The disk, which is of which is normalized, okay, and I will also consider its orthogonal by J. J is the complex structure, which here is complex but can be thought of almost complex. It's also a tangent to the disks and also normalized. Okay. Now you have Gauss equation which tells this. If you start with this Riemann tensor, and you evaluate it on x, jx, jx here, and again x here. So if I put a bar here, this is the Riemann curvature tensor of the ambient metric. Then you might compare this with the same expression, but for the induced metric. And the defect, the difference, you have not an equality like that. The defect, so this is the Riemann curvature tensor on the disk. And the defect is can be explained in terms of the second fundamental form. This is the second fundamental form. So you have a term like that, minus a term like that. This is really a Gauss equation in a modern term, expressed in modern terms. Okay, now B is for those you don't know is so if you start with two vector fields which are tangent to your disk, this is nothing but the covariant derivative of the second with respect to the first one, and you take the normal projection with respect to the normal part of it with respect to the disk. Okay, this is a symmetric form, and the point is that in the Keller case, B is C-linear, meaning that you can extract the J and put it in front of it. So, in particular, you get this,
or that.
And this becomes also a quantity which is positive.
This is obviously positive.
And the other one also. This is in the Keller case. So this is the proof that here now what you have is precisely the Gauss curvature of the induced metric on the disk. And here what you have is what we call, because you evaluate it on X and GX, this is the holomorphic sectional curvature of the ambient manifold. And so you estimate the Gauss curvature of any disk from above by the norm, the maximum, if you want, of the holomorphic sectional curvature on the ambient manifold. Okay? This is really the precise meaning of the vague phrase, sentence I said before. And now, if you don't if you are not in the Keller case, what happens is that you might estimate the difference between these two terms. Namely the sum, difference of the... You might estimate it also by something which depends only on the ambient manifold, which is some constant which is universal, some maybe two or something like that. The norm of the covariant derivative of J. And what we know is that actually in the Keller case, J is parallel, so this vanishes. In the non-Keller case, even complex or even almost complex, you might evaluate by this quantity. And so you get at the end some bound, which is of the following form. The norm of the, some constant, depending only on the norm of the holomorphic sectional curvature, and also the norm of this covariant derivative object. And this estimate any Gauss curvature of an holomorphic disk or an almost complex disk. Okay, it's all what I wanted to say. I skipped some details on the differential equations, but they are very explicit. You can compute in coordinates, which are these coordinates given by the geodesics, which are perpendicular to the boundary explicitly. They have a name, these coordinates. I forgot about this name. But when you compute inside these coordinates, all the differential inequalities which I gave are obvious. So I stop here.